Welcome everyone to a regular service at the Nelson Unitarian Spiritual Center. And John is the song, going to lead us in the song.
Okay. Well, we'll do this three times, and maybe you'll feel good to stand up and do this. Song goes like this. Love is the only power. Love is the only way. Love, 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 love. Watch our circle grow. We start the first time with a hand to the heart. Love is the only power. Love is the only way. Love, 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 love. Watch our circle grow. Hands out just a little bit. Love is the only power. Love is the only way. Many places in Canada, in North America, South America, many places in the world start their Unitarian service by lighting this chalice of light spreads hope for humanity, for love, for all the good things in life, and reminds us of why we come together and we share this very important time for everybody. So with that, I'd like to invite anyone who has a joy or concern who would like to express that and light a candle to honor that situation.
I'm going to light a candle of joy for the internet, because my wife Jacqueline and daughter Jillian are right now in Spain, and I got texts this morning with photos of them on the beach, and I talked to them on FaceTime yesterday and the day before and the day before, and I'm having a great time on this trip. So are they. Yeah. Jillian got her picture taken with Harry Potter, if you can believe it. Yeah, our very spoiled daughter is having a great time.
Those things light much better if you pick them up and turn them sideways.
Yeah. Finally somebody's telling.
True. Somebody want to practice?
I'm joyful that I made it today. I haven't been here for a long time, and I'm so happy to see what a large group this has become since I've been here last.
So, this is a toast, I guess, to all of us.
We should say our names when we speak.
Okay. My name's Craig. And this is a toast to all of us who have, if this gentleman, David Hawkins, is right, it was a tape I was listening to, that we gather together to increase our, I guess, consciousness, to wake up a little bit more. So that's really what's pulling us together, if he's right. Feels like it's right. So, grateful that we're all here. But we want to be here. Grateful that this place is here for us to come to be together.
I'm Marcia, and I'm very thankful that I'm here this morning. I've been really busy, and busy takes us away sometimes from our spiritual selves, and it's really nice to be back in the group. Dale and I would like to share this book into our library. This is a book called Unitarians in Canada, and it's written by an amazing minister who is now the minister emeritus at the Unitarian Church of Vancouver. And it's what brought Dale into Unitarianism, and I came later. He is a wonderful thinker, historian, and really has written a number of amazing books. This is one of them, and I just got it back from Anne, who read it and enjoyed it as well. So we're going to put this in the library here, and it's our donation.
Thank you. Don't forget
to
light your candle.
Oh, my candle. Thank
you.
Thanks.
I'll add a comment to it. I love this book because it really emphasizes the idea of religion should keep up with the times. It should be current. And that's why I like the point in today's sermon that says we are theologically alive. I think that book does it.
I wanted to share a joy. I was not here last Sunday because I unexpectedly got to go to a drum making workshop. I was told it was full, and when I got there, there'd been 4 cancellations. So I made a elk hide First Nations hand drum, and it was a lovely experience, and I feel so blessed that wonderful things happen in our community that I get to go to.
To light a candle for each new face who is here today. Welcome each and every one of you, and hope you will come again.
Concern, and I'm lighting this candle for my best friend Maggie in Fort Worth, Texas, who just called me about her health issues. This is for you, Maggie.
Hi, I'm Dan, and I'm lighting this candle for my friends David and Crystal Sarita and Lyra and Astaria, who just need lots of love right now.
My name's Ray, and about a year ago, I was given this bonnet. And if you have some sense of these bonnets, and if you have some sense of this being...
Speak up a bit, Ray.
Of this being 150 years... of Canada, then you'll know I might need your help holding this.
That's right. And I light this last candle for all the joys and concerns that are held within our hearts and spread throughout all our Unitarian communities. May we send this light forth.
Thank you, John. Now, today we're very pleased to welcome a new speaker, who is Donna Hallman. And Donna is a retired personal counselor with masters in metaphysics and medical Qigong. She has worked on many college and university campuses and has taught several seminaries in communities to assist in personal transitions. Donna has always had a deep understanding of life and knows that we all possess within a love that guides, nurtures, and fills our deepest being. She said the presentation today will go further into this realization of being. As we experience the essence of consciousness and how to experience infinite love in our everyday lives, it will be presented with the very simplicity that it is. What is the difference between self, small letter, and self with a large letter? What is awareness? How do I understand and experience presence? Who and what is a mystic? Why is silence the ultimate state? Within the heart of all existence, we come to realize that there is nothing to acquire, nothing to do, or places to go. For we already are the truth. From here, the beauty of all life unfolds. We're really excited, I've been to some of Donna's classes and really enjoyed them, and I know that you were really happy that she has come today, Donna Hallman.
Speaking into a mic, so just bear with me.
Thank you.
You have to hold it close to your mouth.
Okay. Thank you for inviting me here today and being able to share my
experience
with consciousness and with Dr. Deliver Hawkins. I have to say that my experience with him has completely changed my life. I wasn't brought up in a religious family, although I was brought up with spiritual principles. And I remember a time when I asked my father why we weren't going to church and why and who is God. And he says, Donna, I just want you to walk into the forest and you'll find all your answers there. So I was pretty young at the time, and that's always stayed with me. And having worked as a counselor for over 30 years, seeing clients in a variety of settings, there's a commonality and a common thread through every situation, every dilemma, every crisis that I was there to be with the person. So the first time I read one of Dr. Hawkins' books, and I'm a pretty avid reader of many things spiritual, and I was moved to such an extent that my husband and I drove to Sedona, Arizona for a 2-hour question and answer session. God bless my husband's heart. When he walked out onto the stage, I couldn't stop crying. He came out as a very simple man, and yet he at one time had one of the largest psychiatric practices in New York City. And
bless you.
He gave all that up, packed all his things up in a truck, and moved and led a very solitary life.
No, we can't hear you.
Yeah, there's a reverb. Is there a reverb?
Turn the reverb.
No, I
couldn't
hear you. I can hear you. It's so good. You were talking about the
reverb.
Donna?
Try it now.
The light was.
Check.
David
Hawkins.
Check.
Did she turn off the microphone?
No.
There's a bright golden haze over the manhole.
Might as well make it bright, eh?
Yeah. Whoa.
No, still reverb.
Too much reverb.
There it is.
Dale knows.
Yeah. I knew to go to smile.
Should we try that?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay.
So the name of the person, the being, was Dr. David R. Hawkins. His books, if any of you have ever read them,
read as a meditation. They're, I would say, they're not,
there's so much involved in those books that it's very difficult to read them cover to cover. You don't read them as a novel. You read them as a meditation. And sometimes I'd spend days and days on one paragraph or one sentence. Because the whole beingness with consciousness is not so much learning and intellectualizing. It's more about taking the essence of consciousness and being that essence. So you can take any simple spiritual principle and apply that to everyday life, and that's all you need. So for example, one of the first principles would be to be kind to yourself and to others all the time, without exception. Now that in the heart sounds really easy, and it's easy to be kind to in situations that are easy to be kind in. But with raising levels of consciousness, there's a beingness within that embodies kindness, so that it is within every cell of your body. What Dr. Hawkins did over a 20-year period is he researched millions of people doing arm testing. And arm testing is not something to be taken lightly. Not many people can actually do it. People have to be able to understand and embody the level of truth. People that don't believe in a God can't work with the map of consciousness, it's called. So there's several emergency states that calibrate in such a way that they do not embody the truth. And then there's other states which continuously grow to embody all of truth, all of oneness, and all of beingness. So on this chart, the highest of all levels were Christ, Buddha, Krishna. And beyond that were all the beings in non-physical form. So archangels, angels, and so forth. So this gave me a guide in my life. And it assisted me when I was having experiences of overwhelming infinite love that can knock you over. So in these experiences, it's pretty difficult to function. So you have to learn how to relate in this world, how to interact in this world, how to communicate in this world. Because the body, mind, the personality, these are all things that we've learned and we've acquired belief systems and understanding certain concepts about life. That after a while, you just learn to surrender them. And you surrender them to the divine. What is watching everything in life is the witness. So you can, when you're going through experiences of negative emotion and upset, you have to kind of ask yourself, who is being upset? Because the beingness that you are already is complete. It's all loving. It's infinite. It's nurturing. And we find this place of beingness in the silence. So when you have a time in your everyday life where silence is important to you, and life gets kind of busy and you find that I haven't really had a chance to be in that silent place, and you really find that it's important to find that, people in your life can be, they come to learn over time and understand over time what this is about. Our society praises the extrovert, and people that lead a contemplative life end up being in groups like this, and there's a lot of support from groups like this, so that we can be in a place of beingness where life and love are all existent. So in this map of consciousness then, the higher you go on this map, the happier you are, which is kind of interesting, because you're going into silence and being happy. So the practice of meditation is important. But the only thing with meditation is sometimes it takes us away from living our life. And so it can end up being a little sporadic. Not for all, but for some. And so what happens with consciousness then is we lead a contemplative life and practice our own place of beingness within, regardless of what's happening on the outside. So it's a way of being in the world. So we spend a lot of time teaching our kids, what are you going to do in life? And having worked with young people as a counselor, I could see that there's a definite essence within a human being that is yearning for something. And in those counseling sessions, it was really clear to me what had to be let go of in life and what could be acknowledged and accepted in life. So if we can summarize some of the questions I put forward in the little write-up. First off, the three master's degrees, they were meaningful at the time. This is far more meaningful. And when you're in touch with the infinite that came from before you were born, and the infinite that is going to continue after you pass, and you understand that and be that. Actually, there's no person being anything. It's so impactful in your life that you're never quite the same again. So that's the difference between the small self and the self with a capital S. The small self is the mind that we believe we are, our personality, our name. I mean, someone gave me the name Donna. I'm not Donna. I'm the way we were raised, the important teachers in our life. They were imparting upon us their learnings. So in the sense of beingness in our own lives, we surrender all of it. We surrender all belief systems, all concepts, all learnings. which seems like a pretty big step for just being introduced to consciousness, but I can tell you from doing this for more than 14, 15 years, it's well worth it. Because if you hold on to one particular belief system, there's not a freedom, right? And so in groups like Unitarian, it's free. Like it embodies all faiths and all people. And it's precious to have groups like this. So as you continue on this path, then, through varying levels of consciousness, you see that as you interact with life, you're actually interacting with a variety of levels of consciousness. So depending upon where you are, who you're speaking to, you get a sense and a feel for the consciousness that is in that setting. So in this setting, we have then a morphic field that collects people with a similar heart. And you know, and I know, when we're in other situations where there's conflict, then I've just learned over time that silence is the best thing you can do. Conflict has never really solved anything. A rational mind solves things. Being patient solves things. Now, in my own life, my daughters had heart surgery. My two parents died of cancer. They were together, having cancer together, and I'm an only child. So I don't have brothers or sisters. Plus, I've had just as many tragedies as everyone else in the room, because that is life. Right? Life is bringing these things to us. And consciousness and awareness helps us then to see the essence of what's happening in that moment. Like there is unbelievable beauty in infinite love. And that does not mean personal love. Personal love is something different. Personal love is a back and forth. It's infinite love is exactly what the words say. It's infinite. The other thing that's interesting with this map of consciousness is crime goes down the higher you go on this map. So it's really an interesting thing to understand in your life. It's the only thing that I know of that helps us explain things that we can't hold on to or that we can't intellectualize. You see, intellectualization on the map of consciousness, it peaks at 499. Now what those numbers mean is 10 times 10, 499 times. So these numbers were drawn out from all the various levels of calibrations that were researched and then written about by Dr. Hawkins. Intellectualization combined with spirituality, one helps the other. So it's not, we're not saying intellectualization is wrong or bad, but they work together. And once you start getting to level 600, that's where enlightened states start occurring. And there's very, very few people on the planet that are calibrating in those levels. Most of the world is calibrating under 200, which is not the level of truth. So sometimes when you are going through life and you're thinking, what is happening here? It's happening that way because the consciousness level of the planet, of those countries, and of that situation is not resonating high enough in order to have happiness and peace. The world's been at war steady. My father is in the military, my husband's a retired Air Force pilot. I know lots about the military. And I've chosen to see and experience and be life in a different way. After studying Qigong for many, many years and doing a master's program in Vancouver, it's really clear to me that when a person is kind in one part of the room, it affects everyone. When one person has no judgment of another person, the energy of that permeates everywhere. Compassion, once again, that's an energy, that's a field. A person that is able to communicate wisdom is a field, it's an energy. And we don't necessarily even need to know the details of what's being said. It's something that we can feel in the heart. So the heart energy, we can align ourselves with the Sacred Heart of Jesus, Buddha, for those of you that are interested in some of the Krishna and the more of the Upanishads, the Vedas, the Bhagavad Gita, those calibrate really high. And so you have to kind of say, why is it I believe that map of consciousness so fully? Because when you're a person that understands energy, it's something that after a while you don't even need to arm test things. You already know. So being able to follow and be at peace with your own guidance is the best way to go through life. So as we surrender, if there is a practice, that's it. Included in this, it is the letting go. So in all of life, we're acquiring. We acquire an education, we acquire. With consciousness, you're letting go. You let go. Until you truly are within the realm of the heart, where there is no judgment of this world. And there is only love. So a mystic then, there's lots of mystics in Nelson. They are precious. They don't have to do anything. They just have to do their life. Do all the things you need to do in life and still be aware of the silence, which is indicative of divine presence. So mystics were those who brought us to experience what the great teachers were teaching the world. And from there, man took the teachings and then created things in hopes that that would be like a translation. But in the times of Jesus and Buddha, the consciousness level of the planet was not that high. are dealing with a lot more challenges than we, well, as many of the other water challenges do. But it didn't matter. So it takes a lot of courage to be a person who will live their life from beingness and let go of the learnings, let go of belief systems. And after a while, like the ego will come in and say, yeah, well, just wait a minute, because I'm a judge here. You need to know a few things about survival. So watch the mind, watch the ego, because we all have them. They're the more ancient part of the brain. And just observe it. So whenever something negative is happening in our life, we can just allow it and watch it rather than be in it. Almost like a musical note. You can actually feel an emotion rise and then dissipate. So the idea then is to be in a place of beingness while these negative emotions are passing through your body. If you stifle down negative emotion, you pay the price physically, mentally, all the negative states. I mean, it's, people are innocent. And if we shove down all our fears and angers and pride and desires and try and get through life, it's like we're walking through mud. Whereas if you release it and make your intention every day to be compassionate, kind, loving, but be aware that the ego will come in and say, yeah, but I'm doing that already, it's a piece of cake, I'm going to carry on. That's how the mind works, you see. But these principles are infinite. They almost have their own harmony. So we can go through various stages of spiritual development where sometimes we get kind of upset or angry at a god. And I want you to keep in mind, I want you to keep in mind that God is love, peace, and compassion, and nothing else. Anytime there's a feeling or a teaching that God is anything other than those things is erroneous and needs to be let go. So just in closing, I just wanted to say that walking into the forest was the answer. Good old Dad. You will find all you need in silence. And it's not something that you're going to acquire. It's going to be a beingness. And you'll never feel so much at home ever again. It's like being at home. So I just want to thank you for having me, and I send all of you such love for spending the time and being open to energies and ideas that heal our world. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Lord. Are there any questions anyone had like to ask?
So if you wanted to look into more of what David Hawkins has to say, what would be the first book or tape series, or where would you recommend a person start?
Most people start with Power versus Force.
I'm sorry, what was that?
Most people start with Power versus Force, it's called, and he gets into the quantum mechanics of
measurement
and how it is. Each chapter, he doesn't write anything out of opinion. He calibrates absolutely every chapter, every word. The chapters in this particular book calibrate over 900 every single chapter. So those of you that have been on a spiritual path already may find this one really helpful. The Eye of the Eye. Sometimes people find his writing a little complex. His last one, this one was written just as he was passing away. He had many of his devotees wanting more specifics on how to let go and how to surrender. So this one is actually written in simpler terms.
What's that one called?
This one is called Letting Go. And there's little diaries like this one. I would recommend this because it's actually in Otter's book, I've noticed. It goes through and actually shows you the various stages, because there's the path of no mind, which is the letting go, and there's the path of the heart, and eventually they come together. So in that little book, it just has small little things that you can read in the morning.
And that little book's called?
And it's called Dissolving the Ego, Realizing the Self, for example, that stuff.
Do you have any practical examples?
Of my experience with When I was a counselor, I had a fear of clients committing suicide when I worked with them. And it's something I never wanted ever to happen. And I had just started working with a person that had manic depression, and we'd had our first introductory interview and session together. And my first session was always, it was always free. I just wanted people to get to know me and understand what we were doing. She went home and the next day dropped about 65 tablets. And she was at home with her dad. Her dad had left to work, and she swallowed these pills just after he left. And he had forgotten his keys. So he was able to come back in the house looking for his keys, found his daughter, took her to the hospital, and she lived. Now what that did to me was knock me off my feet a little bit, because I, at the time, was feeling quite distraught about this, because she was no longer able to continue. And I remember one night I was lying in bed, and I had this incredible column of light that came from the divine into my heart. And it lasted a few, I don't even know, I can't remember how long it lasted. I just know that when it was over, when the light dissipated, prayers of love to this particular woman who was just so sad in life. But I no longer take things like that sadly or that personally. And I attribute that to a divine healing.
Someone was a guidance.
Totally.
It was nothing that you did to yourself. It was a guidance.
Right. I was reaching out in my own way. Like a lot of the prayers that you do with Dr. Hawkins are very simple. And sometimes you just surrender it and say, Lord, please help me understand and heal from this. And so you let it over. You give it over to the divine rather than trying to solve it with your intellect. Through the years of counseling, I was trained in verbal counseling, talking therapies, where we explore, we set goals, we reach the goals, sometimes we don't reach the goals, and so on. And I found over time that I was doing therapies that became quieter and quieter. Which is kind of funny. This is where I ended up. Every counselor is going to be different. Every therapy has to be well suited for the consciousness level of the person. And now my greatest heart is with those that are interested in divine love. That truly is all that matters to me now.
Dr. Hawkins has calibrated and put on a graph. Maybe you could tell about the power that is on the planet when one person opens up in a little more love, and how that balances in an extraordinary way and huge numbers of lower consciousness.
Yeah, it's. This is what the chart looks like. It's on one page. So all of life is on one page. If you understand this chart, you'll understand life. And what Dana's talking about is one person that sets the intention in their life to exist within the beingness counterbalances millions of people that are functioning below the level of 200, which is the level of, the start of the level of true love. So he actually has charts, and I don't have the specific numbers, but it's hugely important to understand the impact that one has when one is making that intention in their life. And that's where quantum physics comes in, because you realize that it's not just here. It can be a small little child in Rwanda in a little hospital bed that's passing away. Energy can go that far. So, but it's an interesting road. Because life doesn't really, you want to make sure that you learn how to vary the way you speak when you're in society. You are much smarter actually being what you're talking about rather than talking about it. Because the minute you talk about languaging, the way the body works is all of our concepts and beliefs are stored unconsciously through classical conditioning. So all you need is a symbol, a sound, a look on a person's face, and and your whole body automatically will go into a state that has a history to it. So if you take, for example, fear, fear is something that had a significant emotional event to start with that could have been from the womb, it could have been genealogically, it could have been karmically. And from there, that's the lens through which you're seeing life. So in today's world, if someone has a real problem with a negative emotion and you just happen to say something that sets that chain of events off within the body, what you're getting is the whole line of emotions that have been stacked together. That's why it's important to let them go. Now, some people, just to say letting them go, unless they understand consciousness, that will be difficult, and then the therapy can be used to help people with that. But you're a lot better to be rational rather than pull up your lifetime of memories around a certain negative emotion.
Yeah, very cool.
I really like what you're saying, this is so from the heart. There's one thing you said, I may not have been paying attention, but how do you figure out how to calibrate something? And I don't even know if it's important, because we can feel whether things are true and real and whether love is there. So, but I just, if it's easy to say it.
So just repeat again the actual question.
Well, calibrate. There's 200 and below 200. There's 600. There's 400 and some. How do you arrive at any of that?
So those numbers could have been any set of numbers.
Right.
They could have been anything. It's just within the realm of energy. He was able to come up with various categories. So your arm will actually go weak when you hold a negative, like if you hold something that is an untruth, then your whole body will go weak. Mm-hmm. And there is a point where everything will go strong. And eventually it becomes very clear that having the divine in your life is where the power is coming from, within the heart.
Oh, thank you very much, John.
You're welcome.
I think that time has gone, but I did want Daniel to play one song.
So let's conclude with gratitude from the heart, just by oming. Just one chorus, and we can feel the gratitude that's in the room right now, which is a high level of consciousness. And we can just go into our heart and feel, sense the vibration, the sound, and just allow it to come out at your own pace. Giving thanks.
Thank you.
telephone.
As always, the light never goes out. It stays with us in our hearts. And we take it in the world.
Maybe we could stand up and the announcements are next Sunday. We're going to have Dave Cunningham, who is Elizabeth's husband.
Okay.
And his topic is the devil made me do it. And then on Tuesday evening, we've got, we're starting our Tuesday evening programs. And last Tuesday we had movie night with Bo, and we're hoping to have those once a month. And next Tuesday is going to be men only, men's night out. And it's going to be facilitated by Ray and Marcus. So we hope all the men will come and have a chance to talk amongst themselves without us there.
One thing that I'll say about that, it also includes aspiring men and it's simply not exclusive to men who are attracted to women. If that makes any sense. Good.
And are there any other announcements?
There's the Dances of Universal Peace today at 3 o'clock at the Old Church Hall. We're going to be dancing harmony, love, and beauty.
Okay.
And singing, glad you'd like to join us.
We have a board meeting. It starts in 25 minutes. Everybody's welcome. And one of the interesting things is that Deborah Thorne is going to join us via a conference call or hopefully a Zoom. And she'll be up here at the end of April. But if you would like to stay around, the board meetings are always open. Please feel that free.
And it's downstairs?
We're going to try and be downstairs.
Okay. Thank you. Are there any other announcements? And maybe we've got a time for John. Did we have a closing song?
Okay. Go now in peace,
go now in joy,
may the Spirit of love surround you everywhere, everywhere you may go. Go now in peace,
go now in joy.
Everywhere you may.
coffee and tea and cookies and crackers.
How are you?
How are you?
Good.
Yeah.
I'm reading articles.
He goes back and forth, but he's more than watching the whole thing. He does go back and forth, and there's a lot of routine and stuff. I know. A lot of people don't get more to it, and maybe he's not, because they're still small.
Yeah, I voted for him.
I just said that if we can merge, we can hit you on that now. Like getting a real projector for him would be nice. I have a real projector, and I haven't seen them under $700. I mean, I bought my projector. It was $5,600. That's not much I used to pay. So $740 for real pictures. And it's so worth it. I know.
What I know about them is that they don't exist in isolation. They exist as part of a village. They exist as part of a tradition.
I'm sure you can find it.
All right.
Okay.
And part of the teaching that came with it is that the first coming being is not long for us. Give them the right person at the right time, and that is a
Well, I was already thinking.
It was an autobiography, but a documentary.
Yeah.
As a director, I feel obliged.
You should. Okay, great. That's what we hope, yes. You're going to get a little bit packed up. You guys are welcome to stay, too.
It was interesting today that the bonus
or a laptop. Anybody has a laptop. Whatever we download. There's a laptop.
That helped me know that everyone.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah, we'll write out a share. Yes, that one's perfect. You're fully watching.
Here we go.
Really?